Hello and welcome to News and Views. I'm John Banville. Our guest this week is Senator Joe Robach. Senator Robach, I want to thank you very much for being here today.
Thank you, John. As always, I'm glad to have this opportunity, and I'm battling a pretty good cold, but I didn't want to miss this chance to, you know, fill the folks in on what's going on here in Albany.
There is a lot happening right now. The governor earlier this year unveiled his State of the State, which is really his blueprint for what he wants to achieve in the upcoming year. And he recently unveiled his state budget, which is really where the rubber hits the road. And we've discussed the broad parameters of the state budget and how you feel about the state budget generally. However, many of our viewers at home don't understand the process. What's happening now with Governor Cuomo's budget? And are there specific areas that you, as a representative from Rochester, Western New York, find to be or need to be a priority as we move forward?
Absolutely. One of the things that I guess I always try to applaud or point out what I think is important, I really will applaud the governor for not only making his budget presentation here, but, you know, they've had several presentations to interested parties back home in the district, one at the University of Rochester, by a deputy commissioner. I know Sam Hoyt, who is now working for Empire State Development, even made the budget presentation to the Greece Chamber of Commerce, which I represent. I think there's been other ones. And I think even the governor himself may be coming and be at RIT to present a little bit some of his budget ideas and reform measures that he's talking about. And I really do, I can't say it enough, think that's critically important, both for what outcome we get to, but I am just such a huge believer in openness, transparency, letting the people I have the privilege to represent speak up, whether they're a college, a university, an everyday individual who's utilizing a program here in New York. I think that's vitally important. And I do think, and I should say this before maybe I talk about some of the things I would like to change, it has not always been that way. Having these presentations be more open, utilizing, which we're in right now, the Joint Conference Committee and budget hearing process, for years, Sheldon Silver and my colleagues in the Assembly refused to participate in the open, transparent process and come to conference committees, passing a version of their budget, Senate passing a version of their budget, and then seeing what we had in common with the governor's budget and not, and then working some of those things out in a public open forum. That's critically, critically important. The other thing that happens when the process works right is you have more people not only having mechanisms to speak up, but I think clearly people also, whether it's an email, a letter, or even yesterday in Albany, you know, we had an inordinate amount of people in town in Albany talking about things and impacts for Rochester, from the U of R, you know, Joel Seligman, the president, to Bill Dessler from RIT, to folks from the YMCA, even kids who are utilizing youth programs, the Boys and Girls Club, the YMCA, other things, you know, all here saying, this is what we like, this is what we don't like, what can we expect? So while challenges sometimes often remain as to what that final product is or trying to work within our means, I'm glad there really is both a hearing process, but also an opportunity for people to chime in. And of course, I say this to people and I mean it, not only do you have the opportunity to talk to the man or woman who represents you, I feel you have that obligation. That's when democracy is going to work best, is when we hear from a wide range of people in a wide demographic, that's when it will work optimally.
But Senator Robach, a couple of years ago, this was not being done. In fact, I believe there were a couple of years where the budget process was a violation of the law because you were supposed to have disagreements aired publicly so
right.
that people knew where the leaders and the various houses stood. Do you feel that that process has been corrected?
Yes. You know, clearly, I guess I'll say the good news and the bad news. I think now, because of it becoming the norm and a lot more pressure being put on publicly, and I would say the leadership of Governor Cuomo were following that. But several years back, again, when my colleagues and the assembly leadership didn't follow the process, I think somebody even made the statement in New York City, people don't care about that. Not only were budgets late, but it didn't give as much opportunity for people to speak up. And again, you can't, it's just hypocritical to say you're for an open, transparent process, but then not do the most important thing to air that. But I would say this is shocking to me. I've also heard colleagues of mine, mostly from the other side of the aisle, say that they don't even think if the budget's done on time, it's important. I think we're turning away from that. You know, again, I've never represented New York City, nor do I have any desire to, though I understand it's part of New York and we're all in it together, so to speak. But where I live and the people I represent, they constantly say, keep the fight up on budget reform, timeliness. And I think we operate more under the work ethic. They go to work and they have to do their job and get it done on time. So should the legislature and so should I. But I'm happy to say that people know, you know, that I've stood up in the assembly and how I got to the Senate and it really worked for those reforms and some things that were fundamentally important to us, whether it was having the ability to speak up, getting a budget done on time, or making sure that Rochester and Monroe County tried to get their fair share. And if they didn't, there was a way that we could publicly air that to try and rectify in the next budget cycle. I'm fortunate in that regard. I think people have paid attention to that. While I've had leaders in Albany sometimes not like it and try to make sure that I'm very contested in my elections or grind me down, the most important people, at least to me, are the people I represent. I think they get it and appreciate that. So I'm going to stay on that track. And I do think globally we have moved more in that direction because of the early efforts and, quite frankly, other people embracing it now more and more, both in the public, the media, and I hope Governor Cuomo will stay on that course as well.
Senator Robach, exactly where are we right now in the budget process? And do you see this moving along at a rate where we will have the budget done on time?
That's always a hard question to answer exactly. But, you know, we've had several budgets done on time now in a row, using the more open process and giving a little bit more power and ability to speak to rank and file members. I think that there's a very good likelihood that we'll have the budget done on time, and I hope we do. Again, I haven't even talked about those reforms. I also feel, just like a jury, if the budget isn't ever done in time, we should be sequestered and not be able to do anything else till that job is done. That's clearly one of the most important things we do, and we should take that very seriously. It has a huge impact on everyone's lives, from businesses to not-for-profits, to schools, to everything with state budget. So hopefully that will happen. But right now, I could say, we are on target. We've started hearings. We're going to start joint conference committees. We're doing the mechanisms and creating the opportunities for people to speak up. And I know there's also negotiations, which I don't think are backdoor, with staff, with members, with the second floor, the executive office, his staff, and even the governor himself directly. And the governor continues to travel the state and people that work for him to explain what he's trying to accomplish and hopefully listen to ideas people might have to even be more efficient. You know, the other day, a good idea, they want to create this hotline, you know, for people who have been abused or in a vulnerable condition. I certainly agree with that in scope, but across upstate New York, we've implemented a system called 211. I'm telling them you don't have to spend $15 million, maybe for a much lesser amount of money, some training, maybe a little bit more of employment, investment in that, in the not-for-profits. Association for the Blind and Visually Impaired is our provider in our region. We may be able to accomplish what they want, maybe for a small fraction of what they want to spend it on. in the governor's budget, do it, but do it more efficiently and get it done less. I hope they're listening to all the things people are suggesting and trying to work those things out.
Do you see this as a more of a fine-tuning of the document, or is...
Well, it is, and you know, that is part of the Constitution, the process. The governor has to go first, present his budget. The legislature then must review that and either ratify it or have versions of their own budget and then go to conference committees and try and hammer out the differences. That's a good process. And again, with a renewed focus, if all the parties involved are looking to get that done in time, I think that increases the likelihood much better, and so hopefully that will occur.
I will be following up with you in the future as we progress through the budget negotiations, mm-hmm. just to keep our viewers at home abreast of what's going on and to let them know how this is going to affect them directly. I'd like to shift gears for a moment, Senator Robach. I'd like to talk about the DNA data bank. Can you tell us what it is?
Sure.
And why this proposal is important to you? Because there's a proposal right now in Albany to expand the DNA database to include all misdemeanors and all crimes in New York. And you've said in the past that you think this is a good idea, and I'd like our viewers to know exactly what it is and why.
I am very happy to explain that and glad that the Senate's taken the leadership on that and, you know, working with crime victims, law enforcement from not only Monroe County and Rochester, but all across New York State. We've aggressively gone at that. A very good signal that the governor also talked about that in his State of the State and has included that in his budget package and reform package. DNA, quite frankly, is the fingerprint of the 60s and the 70s, what law enforcement used to use of today. It is a very good technology, very foolproof. It just simply says two things when you have evidence, male or female, is there a match to put that person at the crime, or sometimes, unfortunately, depending on the nature of the crime, can involve very things that only the perpetrator could have put there. But the thing and why I'm so hell-bent on getting this done is, you know, having worked in the criminal justice area in the Department of Public Safety before I came here, working with district attorneys, crime victims groups, and advocates, there's nothing more rewarding to me. We know we can put policies in place that literally will stop victimization. I feel not only should we, I feel obligated that we can. And there was a speaker not too long ago who's really an expert on this and had, you know, gone all over the country. And in New York, it's estimated that if we had this a decade ago, upwards of 2,500 women would have been sexually assaulted and raped had we had this in place by repeat perpetrators and other criminals who would have been captured via the database. And then secondly, approximately 900 people have been murdered by people who have been out of the system. And so I think, and on behalf of trying to save more people from having that terrible fate, more families being victimized, more loved ones lost and damaged, we ought to do this. There's just absolutely no reason to me not to use the best technology to not only get the bad guy off the street, but also can exonerate the innocent. So when I hear these people have these fears, I think they're unfounded. I heard another great anecdote that said, think if you went to a crime scene and there was five people in the room and they said, we're only going to fingerprint the people that are left-handed and we left everybody else out, that would greatly diminish getting the bad guy off the street. I feel the same way on this. So hopefully the governor's on board. We've passed the bill in the Senate on behalf of all crime victims. I hope the Assembly will act accordingly as well.
Well, Senator, we're out of time for this week. I want to thank you very much for giving us the budget update, and I'm sure you'll be letting us know how the DNA database debate continues.
Thank you, John.
Thank you. We'll see you soon.